Two in one day, you guys didn't think? Well, yeah. Two in one day.
All right then, Mr. MatPat. You've had too many accurate predictions too many times lately for anyone without access to a time machine, and we have no choice but to charge you with crimes against the sacred algorithm. How do you plead?
Not guilty! These theories are based on logic, facts, mathematics, literary and cultural analysis.
The algorithm says otherwise, sir. Your sentence is—
Enough! I've my own charge for this court. You say you've created a new original hit streaming series, oh yes. But I theorize you've merely taken three other shows and stuffed them into one. What say you about that?
Prune him.
Coward!
Film theory.
Hello, Internet! Welcome to Film Theory, the show that reminds you that the sacred timeline dictates you will subscribe to this channel for mind-blowing theories every week. Button is right below this video. All unauthorized variants will be deleted in the next 10 seconds. Marvel's Loki is a show about
a lot of things,
but probably the most obvious is time. The nature of it, the reason for it, the existence of it, time travel, time manipulation, timelines, and even people who are running out of it. And boy, can I relate to that last group, as the team and I struggle to get relevant Loki theories up when each and every week has some new massive lore drop. Case in point, just last week we were coming real close to wheels up on a theory grounded in meticulous research of the series' themes, the 80 plus year history of Marvel, the future of the MCU, and the cultural context surrounding all of it, and then this happened. Well, poop. But wait, here's the thing, theorists. No sooner had we scrubbed our whiteboards clean of a week's worth of research than a new, better idea came into the focus. One that not only adheres to comic lore and Easter eggs that we're seeing hidden on the show, but one that perfectly fits Disney's initiatives for this new era of superhero and supervillain. Get this, people. The true villain of Loki and the creator of the TVA is none other than Kang the Conqueror.
Really?
You suck.
Wait, no, don't click off. No, I know everyone and their new rock stars has been predicting this thing for months, ever since the first trailer for Loki came out. And then, literally every single week afterwards. Heck, I even had an earlier theory that briefly commented on the exact same thing. In the comics, this name belongs to a princess, consort, and on-again-off-again romantic interest to Kang the Conqueror. And here's the truth. I think that all us YouTube commentators are right. I see all the evidence pointing to Loki setting up the new guy, Kang, as our big bad moving forward.
Sup, Kang?
But I also think everyone is wrong. Whereas everyone's been expecting a blue-tinted version of Thanos to step out of a time door and announce himself to the world as the MCU's next great conqueror, since that's kind of how he rolls in the comics, I don't think that's what's gonna happen here. Instead, I predict that this is the new face of Kang. Ravonna Renslayer, judge of the TVA, is gonna become your new gender-swapped Kang the Conqueror. Bottom line here, with episode of Loki left to go, I'm here putting all my Dogecoin on the line to take one final swing while I have the chance to predict where it's all headed, what it's supposed to mean, and what it says about the future of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Today, I'm gonna show you that Ravonna is Kang, and also why it matters, since, let's be honest, no one other than comics fans are gonna have a really big response to the name Kang. Okay, so first and foremost, Kang has been pretty well teed up here. As I alluded to before, he's the main Marvel time travel villain who actually does all the time travel hacks that no one else ever really seems to think of, like skipping around through time and teaming up with a bunch of different versions of yourself, or pulling off complex multi-generational schemes. As a side effect of this, there's also a bunch of guys floating around various points of the Marvel timeline that are Kang, but also not Kang. I suppose you could call them, like, Kang variants, to use Loki's own terminology. For example, there's Ramatut, an imposter Egyptian pharaoh who turns out to be a time traveler from the future that the Fantastic Four battles in one of their earliest adventures. That guy is a version of Kang. There's the Scarlet Centurion, whose armor is a choice, but still another version of Kang. Even the founder of the Young Avengers, Iron Lad, turns out to be a teenage Kang who found out about his bad guy future and decided, hey, what if I just don't? There's also a guy called Immortus, who's supposedly the most powerful Kang from even further into the future, who sometimes dislikes the regular Kang and plots against him, and holy Loki, this better make more sense in the movies, right? So the TLDR of all of that is he's a pretty cool character, his lore is really complicated if you choose to go into it, and Loki has been dropping all sorts of hints that were leading up to his big reveal. He's already been hinted at appearing in an upcoming MCU movie, Ant-Man and Quantumania, and Ravonna Renslayer, our antagonistic TVA judge, is a character named after someone who, at least in the comics, really only ever exists in relation to Kang. We're shown Ravonna's Minuteman number is A23, which relates to her comics debut in a Kang story. There's maybe Ramatut's Sphinx ship hidden in the background of the void in episode 5, and the fact that Eliath, the time-devouring monster, is a huge part of that same episode is a big, big clue considering it's a creature from Limbo known to stalk Kang's every move in the comics. Heck, episode 5 even shows us the ruins of a Stark Tower rebranded as Kang Enterprises, a corporation from the comics run by, you guessed it, Kang. Just chooses to respell it a little bit. So who then is hiding in that mysterious house at the end of time? There's only two options, friends. Number one, it's actually a final version of Loki. Ha, caught you by surprise, didn't I? Yeah, this is if they're trolling us with Easter eggs. Go figure that the secret villain of a show named Loki, where a villain named Loki is constantly meeting other versions of himself, would have the big final reveal be one more version of himself. Maybe specifically a version of Loki that's trying to perfect himself through a process of elimination, and that's why the TVA is obsessed with Loki variants. Just saying that the surprise reveal of a Loki at the end of the universe trying to find his glorious purpose, aka a relationship with Sylvie himself, would fit the themes of the show real well.
Who's
personally
Sylvie?
I actually like this option best, but I'm choosing not to focus on it too much because it's more narratively satisfying, but it doesn't have a whole lot of evidence that I can use to build an episode around. But then again, there's always option two. The Easter eggs are all real, and it ends up being Kang. If WandaVision taught us anything, sometimes the obvious clues in front of our faces lead to the obvious answers. Brooch-wearing character in a story about magic powers with a name like Agnes must be the evil witch Agatha pulling the strings. Time travel story with a load of references to Kang. Kang is our big bad. But I'm not entirely sure it's gonna be that cut and dry. See, here's where a lot of people have found themselves unsure when it comes to the idea of Kang the Conqueror showing up in the MCU as a major villain. He's not always that interesting. Sure, he does interesting things, and he's been the catalyst for some interesting stories. Time manipulation and time travel are always gonna be fun. But Kang himself is kind of like the Allen wrench of supervillains. He's useful, but he's not necessarily compelling. Don't get me wrong, the MCU has actually done a pretty good job of disproving the idea that superhero movies always need an interesting villain. Most of them show up, look flashy, and give the hero a chance to confront their real arch nemesis, their own personal flaws and self-doubts. See also Ironmonger, Yellowjacket, Abomination, Mysterio, Aldrich Killian. But the really good ones that you remember, like Killmonger, Thanos, and Loki, are the ones with real depth and personality to them. The ones that you can understand as complete characters. And that is innately hard to do with Kang, where you can never be exactly sure of what point in his development you're meeting him, since he's always bouncing around through time. And what's more frustrating is even if you happen to work out the details, it's hard to create a Kang that's not just, well, Thanos again. Another big, arrogant, powerful dude who thinks he should decide the order of the universe and has the magic sci-fi powers to do it. But this time, he's teal. Fire up those Photoshop color sliders, boys! We got ourselves a new villain! It just feels like we've been there, and that Marvel's smart enough to know that they need something else to set any hypothetical next big nemesis apart from what they just got done with. So what about a new take on Kang? Enter Ravonna Renslayer. If Kang has a hard time being unironically interesting, Ravonna, his sometimes love interest, sometimes sworn nemesis, was really only ever interesting when the comics gave her crazy 90s power armor and started calling her the Terminatrix. Otherwise, her function as a character just boiled down to you being able to tell which Kang you're dealing with based on whether or not she's trying to kill him. That is it. That's not even me trying to be, like, artificially reductive. But you'll notice that one of the big themes that Phase 4 has already devoted a lot of time to is exploring the ramifications of how much roles of authority and power change when you alter the race or gender of the characters filling the position. Falcon and the Winter Soldier was all about how much the symbolism of Captain America changes based on who's carrying the shield. WandaVision was a story that only happened because a powerful woman who had historically kept her powers bottled up finally lets loose at a time of immense grief. And Black Widow has Natasha debating the widow persona's glamorized celebrity status and sexualized acrobatic fighting techniques. Heck, the first big reveal of Loki is a gender-swapped Loki who, as our Loki himself admits, is the only one of the numerous versions that he believes can save the universe. Multiverse or whatever you want to call it. So why not end the series with yet another big reveal, a gender-swapped Kang. Ravonna, as portrayed on the show, fits the theme. In the comics, she's the daughter of a king from the future who Kang tries to marry simply as a part of his quest for power. Using a woman purely as an object? Yeah, that story ain't gonna fly in 2021. And Disney knows it. Thus far, the version of Ravonna on Loki appears to be a much different and much more complex character. A TVA Minuteman risen to the rank of judge who, for most of the series, seemed like the primary villain until, with one episode to go, appears to not actually know what's going on, even as she still works militantly in service of it. You know who would reward that sort of behavior? Herself from the future. You know who would build this sort of strictly regimented bureaucratic TVA system? Ravonna herself, as portrayed on the show. It's a bit confusing because it's one of those chicken and the egg scenarios, but consider this. Ravonna in these final episodes is determined to chase down our variant Lokis to the end of time. Next episode, she's gonna meet them there, they do battle, and she's suddenly stuck at the end of time, giving her the perfect excuse to start the loop again. She survives and uses her knowledge of time to rebuild, going back to the past to create the TVA in the first place. Unknowingly, Ravonna creates the very organization that she serves. That's why the timekeepers had to be androids, because there is no one behind the curtain. It is just Ravonna from the future. The cinematic universe's incarnation of Ravonna isn't Kang's lover, partner, nemesis, or otherwise. She is Kang herself, or she will be after the events of Loki, and this is her origin story. The point is this, that would be quite the twist, but it would also make sense within the actual plot of the series and the meta-narrative of playing around with the expectations of hyper-invested clue-hunting Marvel fans. With Thanos, the good guys of the MCU faced down the end of the world in the form of an omnipotent big bad dad who was absolutely certain he knew what was best for the universe. If we're right about this one, if Ravonna is Kang, her characterization gives us an entirely different type of supervillain, one who's efficient and businesslike, but may also have a deceptively empathetic, this is for your own good, soft touch to their dark tactics, whose overall affect is less about imposing will like Thanos than a kind of evil mother hen vibe, where she genuinely believes that she's leading history itself in the correct direction, which is exactly what Kang has always wanted in his stories. I guess we'll find out tonight. Fingers crossed, friends. But hey, that's just a film theory. One more Kang version that's worth mentioning here. He's also randomly Victor Timely, an 1890s Midwestern American small-town mayor who implants the idea to create a fire-powered synthetic man into the subconscious of Professor Phineas Horton, inspiring him to create Marvel's first superhero, the original World War II-era android Human Torch. In the comics, his android body is what gets rebuilt into the Vision. In the movies, believe it or not, but you've actually already seen that guy. Crazy how these sorts of things come around, isn't it? Anyway, there you go, friends. See you next week.
Wait, that was actually a thing? Huh. Anywho, this is the end of the video, as you can see. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll catch you all in another reaction video. Peace.